Ready to Algebra 1AB. Today we've got 3.4 day 2, continuation on function notation. All right, so we're going to start off with a little exploration here. We've got four graphs and then four different functions written, and we're supposed to match each function with the graph. So we've got A, B, C, and D functions with capital A, B, C, and D graphs. So what we're looking at here, and hopefully we can make the catch here, that two of these graphs are linear, they're straight line graphs, and two of them are not. You can see they bend, they curve. Okay, so how could we possibly sort out which ones of these functions, f, g, h, or j, which one of those happens to be the linear graphs? Because that would be a really big help. All right, and if we take a look, letter A and letter B here, functions f and g, notice how those look like y equals mx plus b. G also looks like mx plus b. These kind of have that mx plus b look to them. That's what we said a linear function will show. So I know that for these two, they have to match up with graphs b or d. All right, so how do we figure out which one is which? Well, let's plug in a zero to each one. So if I were to plug in a zero into f of a, I would have 2 times 0 minus 3. That's 0 minus 3, negative 3. Which one of these graphs, B or D, shows the point 0, negative 3? 0, negative 3, 0, negative 3. Okay, so just by looking at that quick evaluation, I know that function F has to go with graph B. So you can see how our vocabulary and then the evaluating functions we did yesterday, that can help us out a great deal. And we had mentioned casually yesterday that zero is a very good number to plug in because it simplifies so quickly. Now, we know by process of elimination, if we know that g is the only other linear function, we know that should be going along with graph D. So I'm going to pencil that in, but let's double check that. Let's do our plug in zero trick with g. So g of 0 means I take negative 0 and then plus 2. That's just going to be 0 plus 2, isn't it? It'll be 2. So I put in a 0 and I got out a 2, 0 comma 2. 0 comma 2, it's not B. 0 comma 2, it is D. Okay, so we can feel good about that. So looking at functions H and J down here, notice how they don't just have a X, like mx plus b, they have an x to the second power. That's what makes these graphs bend, that higher power on x. We just don't know which one of these x squared functions, the actual name is quadratic, well, that's a second semester topic, but which one of those functions produces which graph. So I'm convinced that h and j both match up with either a or c. Let's do the plug-in zero trick. So if I have 0 to the second power and then minus 1, well, second power just means something times itself, doesn't it? So 0 to the second is 0 times 0, just 0, and then minus 1. So in went a 0 and out came a negative 1, 0 comma negative 1, 0 comma negative 1. If I were to plot those points, you can see that that matches up with our graph of A. So I'm very, very confident that graph C goes along with our last function, J. But let's go ahead and check the, so here, J of 0, 2 times 0 to the second, and then minus 3. 0 to the second power, again, we just got done saying that's 0 times 0. Then we've got, because we do powers and then multiplying, still just order of operations, right? So 2 times 0 is 0 minus 3. That's a negative 3. So I input a 0. The output was negative 3. 0, negative 3. It's not on graph A. 0, negative 3. It is on graph C. So B, D, A, C in order are how the graphs match up with those functions. So just goes to show this, again, in class, this would be a little bit of an exploration, kind of a more of a discussion. What do you see? What patterns do you notice? But for the sake of this video, hopefully we can tell that a lot of what we've been covering vocabulary-wise so far can help us in these types of situations. It really puts everything together quite nicely. All right, so as we move forward in Chapter 3, our main goal is going to be able to graph a linear function. And so, I'm just going to clean this up. That was bugging me a little bit. All right, so for letter A, here we've got a linear function, and we are told the word linear, so I know those points should line up to make a straight line graph. So let's go ahead and pick some values, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, and 2, just like we did in the video yesterday, or in the lesson yesterday. And our function is going to be negative x and then plus 4. So negative, negative 2, and then plus 4. Well, let's see. Negative, negative 2 is positive 2 plus 4. That must be 6. So from the origin to plot that point, I'm pairing up a negative 2 with a 6. Negative 2, 6 is my first point. Second input is going to be a negative 1. That's negative, negative 1, and then plus 4. Again, just following the rule. Negative, negative 1, that's really multiplies together to make a positive 1, doesn't it? And then plus 4 gives me a 5. So negative 1 and then up 5. Next, we've got a 0. Negative 0 and then plus 4. Man, zeros are nice. Negative 0 is just 0 plus 4, which totals up to 4. So I don't go left or right. I just go straight up from the origin 4 units. 1. Negative 1 and then plus 4, dot, dot, dot. Well, negative times 1 is just negative 1. Negative 1 plus 4 is 3. And some of you may be good at finding the constant rate of change in your table of values. If you're noticing that stuff, that's great. And no point does it say we have to fill in this table of values or anything like that. I like to show it because you never know when you're going to get stuck on a graph, and this will always get you by. So I like to show the steps just in case. But if you catch some patterns here, they're generally pretty trustworthy, especially because they said the word linear. All right, so our final value was a 2 to plug in. Negative 2 and then plus 4 gives me a positive 2. Because they say it's a linear function, I want to be sure to connect those points with a straight line graph. So we'll do that right there. Looks perfect. Okay, if I were sitting in your place, I'd be using, oh, like an ID card or a ruler if you've got it, or a protractor or something. Make sure you've got a straight edge. It has to be a straight line graph. All right, so next one, letter B. Ooh, before I start filling this one in, I notice a fraction, and I haven't seen that yet. If you ever do notice a fraction, you can make your life a lot easier. Yes, we can use the calculator, so it doesn't really scare us a whole lot, but to make it easiest on us to plot points, notice how this has a fraction that has something, and it's divided by 4. That means if my inputs are multiples of 4, the answer is going to come out more cleanly. Okay, so we want to undo the fractions dividing by 4 by choosing multiples of 4. So for my x values, I want to put 0 in the middle. I like having that. But then instead of choosing 1 and negative 1, I'm going to choose negative 4 and positive 4. Instead of choosing negative 2 and positive 2, I'm going to choose negative 8 and positive 8. Again, choosing these multiples of 4. So a really, really neat thing happens. Let's start figuring out these outputs, these h of x outputs. If I have negative 3/4 times negative 8 and then minus 1, that's what the rule is telling me to do. In the calculator, if I try negative 3/4 times negative 8, I actually just get a positive 6 minus 1. So the answer comes out super clean, but that's because we chose multiples of 4. I don't see any decimals or like weird stuff that would be really hard to graph. So if I go over to negative 8 and then up to 5, there's my first point. If I plug in a negative 4, negative 3 fourths times negative 4 minus 1. Again, you can use the calculator to figure this out if you'd like, but negative 3 fourths of negative 4 is positive 3 minus 1, which is 2. So at negative 4, I'm up to 2. And you can see my points are very spaced out, but that's because I only chose multiples of 4, so those inputs are going to be much more spaced out. All right, let's try 0. Always a treasure. Negative 3 fourths times 0 and then minus 1. Well, even if it's a fraction, something times 0 is going to come out as a 0. Minus 1, that answers negative 1. And I'm just going to check. I've only done a few, but does it appear that my points are making a straight line graph, a linear function? They mentioned that in the instructions, so I should be seeing it, and I am. That makes me feel a little bit more confident that we're on the right track. Negative 3 fourths times 4, and then minus 1 is my next one. Negative 3 fourths times negative 4 is negative 3 minus 1, so I get negative 4 as an output. So I go over to 4 and down to negative 4, there's my next point. And then lastly, if I plug in an 8, negative 3 fourths times positive 8 minus 1, that gives me negative 6 minus 1, which is negative 7. So I'm going to go over to positive 8, and then I'm going to go down to negative 7, and there's my next point. And you can see, plotting those, I get a perfect straight line graph. Connect those points up with a straight edge, and we've got our function graphed. But that's a nice trick that doesn't show up a lot, is when you see fractions in your work, you can help your table to come out clean and give you the easiest points to plot by choosing multiples of the denominator. So here, our fraction said divided by 4, choose multiples of 4, and you'll get clean answers. All right, and then we got a few questions here at the end that I really, really like, because they just show, do we understand how to read this f of x language, our function notation? Find the value of x, so I'm looking for an x value down here, so that f of x equals 7. Well, f of x, remember, is my output, sometimes called the y value. So my outputs are here. All right, so my output would be 7 right here, wouldn't it? So I'm just going to kind of follow this line. Here's an output of 7. Which x value down here matches up with that height of 7 that we wanted the output to produce? Well, here is where the graph perfectly hits that height of 7, what x value would that point have? It's not labeled here, but it's right in the middle of 4 and 6, so it's 5. We can answer that problem, x equals 5, without doing any solving, as long as we know how to read the graph. Letter B is the same exact prompt. Okay, so now our output, the graph, it looks a little different, right? Because we've got the axes, the black lines here, are kind of going through, not perfectly in the middle. But here, this y-axis up here, all we can see is a 2 and a 6 on there showing where our outputs are at. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That means 7 would be right up here. And again, that vertical axis is our outputs, usually y. All right, I'm looking for an answer reading the numbers off the x-axis, those are my inputs. And that top red line is where my output was 7. And if I take a look, this, it's just at the very tip of that arrow that they've drawn in there where the output of that function is 7. So we're supposed to find the value of x, though. So that point matches up with where on the x-axis? It's down here. Let's see, this would be negative 1, there's negative 2, this would be the next one. So we can say x equals negative 3 is the input, the x number, that matches up with where that line hits a height of 7. All right, next, example 3, the function c of x equals 17.5x minus 10 represents the cost in dollars of buying X tickets to the orchestra with a $10 coupon. How much does it cost to buy 5 tickets? Okay, so let's see. They tell us that X is the number of tickets. So X is our input. It's the number of tickets that we buy. And then C, the whole thing, C of X, C is the cost for an output. All right, so when they ask us how much does it cost, we're looking for an output. We want the cost if we buy 5 tickets. Let's replace the X, the input, the number of tickets, with 5. All right. And we'll go ahead and use a calculator with this, with the decimals involved, just to make sure we do all of that work correctly. Let's type that in real quickly. I'm just doing 17.5 times 5 minus 10. And I get 77.5. All right, now I just want to make sure that I show that as a dollar amount. $77.50 would get us those 5 concert tickets. Letter B says, how many tickets can you buy? So here we're looking for X. Can you buy with $130? Remember, the dollar amount, the cost, that's our output. So here, 130 is going to equal 17.5X minus 10. And we're trying to find the tickets, but we know the cost. Well, here we have to do a little solving. I'm going to add 10 on both sides. 140 is equal to 17.5x, 17.5 times x. And if I divide away the 17.5 on both sides, I'll have my answer. So 140 divided by 17.5 gives me 8. So I would answer with 8 tickets. All right, again, straightforward. It's the same math. We just have to kind of build the equation. We're just not told, hey, solve this. We have to kind of build that on our own. All right. Moving down a little bit more here. Example 4, another modeling with mathematics problem here. The function d of t equals 300,000 t. That represents the distance that light travels in t seconds. Now that's a pretty alarming number. If you were to think, if t were to equal just 1 second, that means light traveled 300,000 kilometers in that 1 second. All right, so let's just take a look, make sure we know if you can turn things into inputs and outputs, that's incredibly beneficial. So d of t, all of that is our output. It's a distance. It's the kilometers. Inside the parentheses, we can see the t. That's our input. That's the time. That's the number of seconds. So the first question is how far? They're asking for a distance, and we know the time is 15. So I'm going to take my distance function that they gave me, and I'm going to plug in a 15. That equals 300,000 times 15. And again, may want to use a calculator with these large numbers, but what we get is 4,500,000 kilometers. Now, you'll notice that when I did this, I did not use commas when I was doing the math. I don't want to mistake those as a decimal point or a multiplication dot or something. So commas are perfectly fine in the question or in the final answer, but in your work, it's a good idea to just use like a little bit of extra space. I kind of did that there, just so we don't confuse ourselves, right? Letter B says, how long? So we're looking for a time. Does it take light to travel 12 million kilometers? So there is a distance. So if I know 12, not 12,000, 12 million equals 300,000 t, that's the equation that we're going to solve. So this time we are plugging in the distance, the output, but we're trying to find the input t. And all I have to do, believe it or not, even with these massive numbers, is division. I'm going to divide both sides by 300,000. And we'll get our answer. Now, you may not have seen this trick before, maybe. But when you're dividing numbers like this that have a lot of zeros at the end of them, you're allowed to cancel out the zeros as long as they match up top and bottom. So this is really the same answer I would get as if I just did 120 divided by 3. The answer is 40. Okay, so that 40 was a time measurement. We would answer with the answer of 40 seconds. Okay, now again, I showed you the little trick here. You're more than welcome to use a calculator. Please don't feel like I'm trying to force these on you. All right, now our next examples here to wrap things up as we get closer to the end, interpreting function notation. So again, remember, interpreting, they're not telling us to solve anything. We're just trying to put words on these numbers. So again, let's just figure out what's the input, what's the output, what labels do those mean? So let h of x, so this is our output, it's the percent of U.S. households, I believe with internet access, with internet use, x years after 1980. Okay, so the output is a percentage of homes. The input x, squeak that onto the screen here, the input is years after 1980. Okay, so let's take a look at letter A, and this is probably the one that we're going to have to know the most. We're going to talk about some of these weirder ones here at the end, just to get us talking mathematically and recognizing these symbols. But the first one, speaking in terms of this class, is the one that we really need to be confident with. There will be a couple of these on your test. So notice that this says, when I input a 23, h of 23, the function h, the output equals 55. So the output was our percentage of homes. So 55% of homes had internet. And then the input was 23. That's the years after 1980. So how would I write that? 23 years after 1980 was 2003. And that's all we have to do, put the labels on the numbers. What does the 55 mean? What does the 23 mean? And we've got our answer. Letter B, if I input a 4, the output is just some unknown number k. So we're going to follow the same procedure as up above. Some unknown k percent of homes had internet in, okay, that's 4. That's 4 years after 1980 in 1984. Okay. Next, notice that we have a greater than or equal to symbol instead of just an equals. So instead of saying exactly 55% of homes, we're inputting 27 years. Our output is just over 61, right? 61% or more. Okay, so I would just say not over, but at least 61% of homes had internet in, and let's see, our year 27 years after 1980 would be 2007, wouldn't it? And by using the words at least, that means that I could be talking about 61% or anything higher. At the least, it could be 61, but it could be greater than that as well. There's the greater than symbol. All right, and then the last one. This one's really a doozy. This wavy equal sign means approximately. So it's not exactly equal, but it's close. And remember, these are outputs. So this first statement right here is and I'm just going to use some symbols so I can fit this all on the screen. The percent of homes in, let's see, 17 years after 1980, that would be 1997 with internet. And percent of homes in 2001, which would be 21 years after 1980 with internet. Total or sum, approximately, there's a lot of writing, the percent of homes in 2009 with internet. So that's basically saying that the percent of all homes in the U.S. with internet in 1997 plus the percent of homes with all, or percent of all homes with the internet in 2001, those two percentages combined add up to something that's about the same number of households in 2009, saying that we're getting a lot of rapid homes with internet connectivity happening. All right, example six, here's another one of that type. Let C of T be the number of customers in a restaurant T hours after 8 a.m. Okay, so I'm just gonna jot this down here. C of T is our output. It's the number of customers. Our input, T, is the hours after 8 a.m. So letter A, again, this is the one that you're going to have to be familiar with for your test. C of 0 equals 0. Well, input is a 0. The output is a 0. That means there are 0 customers 0 hours after 8 a.m. So maybe that's when they're just about to open. Nobody's come into the restaurant yet that day. Something like that. That makes sense. Letter B. Okay, here I'm comparing two outputs. The number of customers. You spell customers C-U-S-T-O-M-E-R-S. At, let's see, 3 hours after 8 a.m., that's 11 a.m., is equal to, or let's just say equals, the number of customers at, what would C of 8 be? 8 hours after 8 a.m. would be 4 p.m. And I just counted those off, you know, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That gets us to noon. That's 4 hours. And then we still got four more to go, right? 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Okay. Letter C here, we do not know the input, but we know that the output, the number of customers, is 29. So 29 customers N hours after 8 a.m. In other words, there's some unknown time where we had exactly 29 people in the restaurant. All right. And lastly here, the number of customers 13 hours after 8 a.m. Again, these are outputs, so I know it's some number of customers, is less than the number of customers at 8 p.m., which makes sense, right? As you get later into the night, your restaurant is probably having people going home. So you probably still had some people finishing dinner at 8 p.m., then they left the restaurant, so the number of customers 13 hours later is less than the number of customers 12 hours after you opened. It makes sense. All right, and our final example, the graph that's over here on the right, I'll go over to that in just a second, shows the number of miles a helicopter is from its destination after X hours on its first flight. Okay, so the graph is the first flight. On its second flight, the helicopter travels 50 miles further and increases its speed by 25 miles per hour. The function f of x represents this second flight, where f of x is the number of miles the helicopter is from its destination after x hours. So we've got the same inputs and outputs. One of these trips is graphed, the other one's given as a function. So I'm just going to write that function over here so I can slide the screen over. 350 minus 125x. And I'm just going to put second for the second flight. Okay, so if I go over to see the graph here, we're supposed to figure out which flight takes less time. All right, so let's see. The distance away is what this f of x, this output, is telling us. So at the very start of the flight, you can see this helicopter is 300 miles away. But then as the hours go by, notice how this line comes down and down and down and down, eventually getting to zero, meaning we are 0 miles away. We have reached our destination. Okay, so the first flight, if we had to look at that graph and say, well, the length of the flight is just how many hours went by until we got to the end, right? Until we got to this place where we hit the x-axis. That's 3 hours. Now let's take a look at the second flight. We're starting off further away, but we're also traveling faster. So if we want to find out, remember, f of x means the distance away. If I want to find out how long the flight took, I want to find out the x, the hours it takes, just like in the graph, but I want to end up when I'm 0 miles away, right? Just like before. So if I say 0 miles away, that means I'm replacing the f of x with a zero. And then if I solve for x, that will give me the number of hours. Okay, so let's see, how would we solve this one for x? I would probably subtract 350 from both sides. And then I'd say, okay, well, here we can go ahead and divide away that negative 125 from both sides. And let's see what that tells us in the calculator. 350 divided by 125. I get 2.8. So the second flight took us 2.8 hours. Therefore, the second flight is the faster one. It took less time. Now, they were very, very close, but the second one was noticeably quicker. All right, everybody, that's going to do it here for Algebra 1AB 3.4 Day 2. Hope you feel like you got a pretty good understanding of this function notation. It's just substituting and being able to tell inputs and outputs. All right, thank you for watching, everybody, and I'll catch you on the